Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm honored and delighted to introduce our keynote speaker today, Dr. Claude Gomez. Dr. Gomez is the CEO of SciLab Enterprises. He was a senior scientist at INRIA in France, where he worked in the areas of computer algebra, control, and numerical computations. He then headed the SciLab research and development team before becoming the director of SciLab Consortium in 2008. He has been involved in the development of SciLab since 1990. His development work includes a Maple package that generates SciLab code from Maple. He has also co-authored the MetaNet toolbox that is used for graphs and network optimization, and also the Pandora expert system that can be used to solve stochastic control problems. Today, Dr. Gomez's talk will be on SciLab, present and future. On behalf of everyone present here, I welcome Dr. Claude Gomez.
Well, good morning to everybody. The first thing I want to say is that I'm very pleased to be here, to be invited to come here. And as I said to other people, the first time I came here was in 2000 in Bhubaneswar for 1 week courses about SciLab. Okay. Then I came here in 2007 for 2 days workshop about SciLab with Professor Kanan. And now, in 2014, for SciLab conference. So I'm coming here in India every 7 years for SciLab. And I'm wondering what I will do in 2021. But saying this shows that it's a very long story, a very long story for SciLab and SciLab in India. So I'm very pleased to be here for that. Okay, many things to say about SciLab, so I try to it's okay. So, just one word, why does SciLab exist? Because we all think that in the domain of numerical computation, for making additions, multiplications, matrix computation, we don't have to pay for that. It's the minimum. We don't have to pay for making these kind of things, for education, for research, and even for industry. And is the reason why SciLab exists and is made for that. So, I need to speak a little about SciLab. Perhaps I'm going to tell things that everybody knows, but let me say what SciLab is. Open source software for numerical computation. It's matrix computation. So, it has everything that we would like to have with this kind of software. Language, functions, structures. You can put SciLab in your application if you want. It's very easy to do. And from SciLab, you can use other kind of software. Okay? Today, what we call SciLab distribution, what is free, is what you download from our website on the internet. For Windows, for Linux, for macOS. And when you have SciLab, which is this free distribution, in fact, you have three things. SciLab, for making computation. XCOS, which is comparable to Simulink for the modeling and the simulation of dynamical systems, and atoms, which allow to download interactively from the internet other modules, other toolbox in SciLab. I will come back to this point later, because for me it's very important for the diffusion of SciLab and the diffusion of the works you do with Scilab. Okay, so very simple. Scilab, a lot of functions for mathematical applied mathematics. I don't want to get back to this point. Okay. Now, with Scilab, you can do very beautiful and useful graphical user interfaces. With the latest version of Scilab, the 5.5.1, we improved a lot this way. We have functionalities with a number of objects, like sliders, like buttons, and everything. And there is a complete interaction between Scilab and the plots and the graphics and so on. You can put graphics in your graphic user interface. You can do everything you want, okay? And now, when you make your graphic user interface with Scilab, it has the look and feel of the system. If it is Linux, it's Linux. If it is Windows, it's Windows. If it is macOS, it is macOS. And an improvement. Now, you can save your graphic interface in XML. And then, with the saved XML file, you can load the XML file to have your graphic user interface. So you can even, if you want, make your classic graphic user interface directly in XML files. Okay. The idea in the future is to have a GUI builder. To have a GUI builder, like many other software have, you can drop and drop sliders, buttons, everything. It's not that you don't want to have it, but you need time and manpower to do it. This is the problem, okay? And with XML, it will be easier to do that. Xcos. You know what Xcos is? It's like a little like Simulink with difference because for dynamical system, it's very powerful to treat continuous and discrete system. You can mix everything, and it is made in a very mathematical and right way. And what you have is this thing. You have a Modelica compiler. Yesterday, people talked about Open Modelica. This is not Open Modelica. It's a free Modelica compiler made years ago, okay, and that allowed to take Modelica blocks in Xcos to generate C code, to compile the C code, and then to put it into Xcos. It's the way it works. But it's an old Modelica compiler. So we had the plan, and we are working now with the Open Modelica consortium with Peter Friedson in order to replace this compiler by the Open Modelica compiler in order to have the up-to-date comprehension of the language of the Open Modelica language, okay? We are working on that, and it will be a major improvement for that. You know that MATLAB has Simscape for doing this kind of thing, but I think that Modelica, when we have Open Modelica compiler here, it will be more powerful because it is a standard. In Europe, all the main car builders, plane builders, rocket builders use Modelica. So it's very important to have a Modelica into Scilab. But waiting for that, good news, you already have modules which call Coselica with 200 acausal blocks for electrical system, mechanical system, and thermic system. You can download it as an atom module and use them like this. This is very powerful, and what we like to have more and more blocks. And to create blocks is easy. You write it in your modelical language, which is very simple, and then it is transformed into Xcos block. Okay. There is now a very interesting question. First, why using Scilab? Free open source. So it's good because it costs no money. Okay? Easy to install everywhere. Large community of users. You are part of them. Okay. But I'm sorry to say that. Freedom is not enough. Why? Because there are two very important points. One, if you have a very bad free software, nobody will use it. So it's very important to have a very good software with many toolboxes for most of applied mathematics, all the functionalities, with its own very good graphics for numerical computation, for a very good Xcos, and easy to add modules, and very friendly to use. In the old time, when they asked me to take Scilab in charge, when the Scilab consortium was created, we had Scilab. It was good. It worked. My first point was to say, we need to have this software very easy to use, even in high school. If people from high school and mathematics teachers are able to use it, everybody in the world will be able to use it. And this is very, very important. And we tried hard in order to have the Scilab we have today, which is used in high school in France. This is the first point. We need that. The second one is, who is in charge of Scilab today? Usually, people say, it's INRIA, French Research Institute for Computer Science and Control. Other people say, it's the community. What does that mean? Everybody in the world is in charge of Scilab? This doesn't work. So we need an organization taking care of Scilab, and for Linux is the same, for GCC compiler is the same, for Python is the same, and so on. There is an organization, a consortium, an association, something, okay? We develop in Scilab in a professional way and giving support and services. This is very important for industry, for companies. And if you want that Scilab be used everywhere, it must be used in the industry. If you want Scilab to be used in the industry, it must be used. It must be have support and services. We met in the old times people in big companies for saying, you use MATLAB, it's very expensive. Why don't you use Scilab? They say, okay, no problem. But if I have a problem with Scilab, what can I do? We said, nothing. So, bye-bye. So we need to have something. And is the reason why we create Scilab Enterprise. So the story of Scilab is very simple. First, in the 80s, the first MATLAB made by Clive Moller, written in Fortran code. Are there young people knowing Fortran code here? Yeah, no? And that was free. It was free. And from this free MATLAB, at INRIA, which already existed, we create another software that was called Basil. And in 1980, only one software for numerical computation exists in the world. It's called MATLAB, made by the BatWorks. It is a very good software, and all these similar software died because they were bad in comparison. So what happens at this time is that this software that was sold by a subsidiary of Inuria came back to Inuria. And then there were six researchers saying, what are we going to do with this? We worked 10 years for this software. MATLAB is the best. We got an idea. We have to give it. So to give it to everybody. And 1990 is the beginning of Linux. So we made free software, but we even know that it was free software. We want to give it. But to give it, we need to improve it, because it was not in a state where people can use it very easily. So we worked from 2003 to have an open source Scilab. And the 2nd of January of 1994, we put it for free, the first Scilab version. It was Scilab 1.1, Scilab 1.0 never existed. And it was put on the, not on the internet, on anonymous FTP. I did it at this time. It was the first version, okay, of Scilab. So 20 years now is a birthday, 20 years of Scilab. And then we, Inuria, asked us to industrialize this software because there were people downloading it. There were 3,000 downloads. So Inuria said, there are customers, we need to do something. We don't have to let this software in the hands of researchers. So we create the Scilab consortium, phase one, phase two, and at the end, when we thought that it was made, the industrialization for made, the plan was Inuria is not made for making software. Inuria is made for research, so Scilab has to get out of Inuria. And the Scilab Enterprises company was created. So in 2010, the company was created from Inuria in order to distribute Scilab software. Okay? And now it has the exclusivity of the name of Scilab given by Inuria, and we are the official structure developing Scilab. So who is in charge of Scilab? Scilab Enterprises, which is now a company with about 20 people. Is what I said yesterday, 22,000. But it's the beginning. I hope it will be better in the future. Who is at the head of Scilab? President, Vice President, CEO, and this guy. I don't know if you know him. It is the chairman of Airbus Group. So this is very important to have this kind of people supporting a lot Scilab Enterprises. Okay. When I came to see this guy and asked him, do you want to put money in Scilab Enterprises? He said to me, to do what? I say, it's very simple. It's to sell a free software. So he told me, are you crazy? Do you want me to put money in a company? We're going to distribute a free software? So I explained that. Scilab Enterprises develop and publish Scilab with free. And what we want to do is getting money with that. services, consulting, migration, and products. And this point is important because you see this. External commercial modules. I will get back to this point later. So, we give the software, and we get money with that. Until now, it works, because we are able to feed 20 people. We hope that it will work more and more in the future. Funding. Okay. We are not alone, because, as I said, 20 people is not a lot. So there is a community. Now there are about 100,000 downloads of Scilab every month. So these are the downloads from July 2007 to November. These are the downloads every month. And this is a cubic line computed with Scilab. Okay. We use Scilab for everything. So this is very important. We don't know who downloads Scilab. We don't know what they do. We don't know if it downloaded it to put in the trash. But what we know is that it is increasing. And this is very important for everybody. Okay? So this is not 90% of French guys downloading Scilab. French is 15%. So there are 150 countries. And in the 10 top, there are India, there are Japan, there are Germany, there are countries like that. It's very funny. There are countries making cars. I don't know why. But if you see the top 10, there are countries making cars. Okay. We have also an international partnership committee, which beginning with a big French high school, big French universities and companies. You know this company, I think. And we are also creating regional groups. We are working with that in order to have people telling us what we have to do, in which direction we have to develop, and so on. Because we it's impossible to work if we are alone. In France, all the red are customers of Scilab Enterprises. Okay. And what is important here is this and this. This is the French Agency for Army. And this is this French Agency for Nuclear. Nuclear French Agency, military French agency. And they plan with us to pass from MATLAB to Scilab in 5 years. Not everything, but nearly 80%. Why? It's not only the price, because they have the means to pay for MATLAB. So the price is a good thing, but come after. What is very important for us is that it is open source. And that they have support. And open source, why? Because it can look at the code and they can see that there is no spy in the binary. When you buy a binary software, you don't know what there is. When this company, Thales, which is a big French company, not only French, for defense, buy a software, they take it and they try to look in the binary software if there are spies and things like that. For Scilab, no need. No need to do that. So, you heard about the NSA in the US. We tried to, the American agency, we tried to to church everything everywhere, Scilab is NSA free. So there is no problem for that. Okay? And in education. Okay. So, one point for us. Scilab is a French product. Okay? So, you must think that, so in France, every school, every high school, every university use Scilab. I'm sorry, but not. Because, like everywhere in the world, is very conservative, and we need years and years and discussion and see the guys and speak with them. So for the first time in the history of the French national education, in the programs, because we have programs, we say what they have to do. They put the name of a software. Because usually they don't say. They say, use a software for numerical computation, or, but they don't want to put a software. For the first time, they put Scilab for this kind of thing that exists only in France, which are 2 years after high school for preparing the very big engineer school in France, engineer schools, and for economics business school. And this is very important for us because the engineers that we go in the school, we all know what Scilab is. So, only now, but we did the best we can, okay? And we made things for them, booklets and things like that, for help them to learn Scilab in the domain of mathematics and engineering science. So this is very important, this thing, for France. This can be replicated everywhere. And I know that you try to do the same thing. So in France, some high school use Scilab. The other point, very important, is that Scilab is open source and is not closed. So it's easy to extend Scilab. This is very important with extending Scilab. Okay? This is Scilab. Oh, this is a puffin. Okay? Scilab mascot. Linux has a penguin. We have a puffin. There is a difference. The puffin can fly. Penguin, I'm not sure. Okay. This is Scilab. Distribution. What you get on the internet. This is with function, language, graphic, discourse, and so on. This is free. This will remain free. This is a commitment we have. It's a mission given by INRIA. And a part of Scilab belongs to INRIA. Because usually, when I talk about Scilab, there is always one question, now it's free, but tomorrow. So what we call the Scilab distribution is free. And will remain free. And anyway, we have GPL code into Scilab. So it will be very difficult. You must know that in Scilab, all the mathematical computation, we didn't made everything. We took LAPACK, we took other kind of things. And some part we took is GPL. And Scilab is GPL. It has a French flavor license, but it's completely GPL compatible according to Richard Stallman. So it's no problem for that. Okay? So free means this. And we have external modules. We call them modules. It's the same as toolbox. But toolbox for MATLAB, so we call them modules. Okay. These modules are as you want. Can be open source, closed source, free, not free, commercial, not commercial, as you want. Okay. This is free. This is as you want. And when you add the module, you do the following. This is Scilab.
Not very beautiful. This is the interpreter, the graphics user interface, Fortran C code, Scilab code, documentation, the user. And when you make a module, you add this. Documentation is here Fortran C code or C++. In Scilab now there is C code. Tomorrow there will be C++ and Scilab code. The main part of Scilab is written in Scilab. So this is the external module. Okay? So if it is Scilab code, no problem. If it is Fortran C or C++, you need to compile it. So, look, Scilab code, Fortran, C, C++. For that, you have a program. You create what we call a C gateway, not very complicated. It is explained how to do that, to link the code to Scilab. Java now, because we have now, since Scilab 5.5.1, we have JIMS, which is Java Interaction Mechanism. We allow to, from Java, to speak to Java with send commands and so on. And I can remember the first or second conference this morning about Fortran code. You were using Fortran code. It said you, why don't you using Scilab? You can do both. If you have your own Fortran code with very complex algorithms, you don't have to write again in Scilab. You compile it and you put it into Scilab as a Scilab function. And more than that, you can give it to the world. Because if you want to give a Fortran software to somebody, not very easy. If you give a Scilab module, it's very easy. So when people have programs and they say, I don't want to rewrite them in Scilab, no. You put them in Scilab. It's not exactly the same thing. And so, with Atom system, you have that. It's independent of Scilab release because when you want, you made another version of your Atom system. It works everywhere. Why? I will explain to you later. And if there are modules dependent on other modules, there are dependencies on the other modules. Because what you have to do, you have to organize your files in directories. Everything is displayed here. Very simple. And you can have what you want. And then you upload the source of your Scilab module to the Atom's Scilab website. And we do the job. We make the atomization. So we compile. And you don't have to do it. If it works. If there are bugs, there are bugs. But you don't have to do it. You put your C code, and we compile it for all the architecture. Okay? So it's very easy to do a thing like that. And for a company, usually company have a Scilab code in one place, in another place, in one business unit, in another. And it's very complicated to give them this code, they can have an internal Atom server. For the two big French agencies I was speaking before, we installed them very recently an Atom server for them. And even if these guys are not on the internet, because it's closed, but they have the Atom server, and they can share the work they do. So this is very important for us. Fast deployment and easy maintenance. So it's a way to solve the problem of I modify a module, how can I give it to all the other people with the system? Okay.
And after that, from the, your Scilab, you can download, as you know, the module you want. Okay. This is very difficult. Usually people say, ah, Scilab in future. I told you yesterday that I'm sorry, I'm not able to do. I see people doing this. I don't want to try it now. But I will practice. But in France, we are not accustomed to that. I was very impressed. Oh. So the Scilab future. The Scilab future, I said yesterday that we know and we would like to do many things in Scilab. Many things are still missing, and we would like to add all the things. But we need manpower. So what is important is code generation and high-performance computing. No, high-performance computing is simply using Scilab here, because I have two cores and four threads. So it's intensive computation, okay? And for that, we need to change Scilab. And here, it's generation with Xcos, because every people using Simulink usually is for generating code, for FPG, for and so on. So we Scilab for the future, we Scilab sits with a new kernel, new memory management, and new parser. And I have a good news, because I'm talking about Scilab 6. I've talked about Scilab 6 for at least 5 years, and nothing happens. And this is important too. We don't have to change. Because here, we change this and this. So the link here has to be changed. So we need to change all the links between the 700C and Fortran functions. It's a huge work. You did it. It's finished. We are not now in the debugging phase. So next year, there will be a version of Scilab 6, okay, which is very important. And now, I will show you. I will show you, and for that, I take a very simple but useful example. 80% of people using Scilab take data, plot data, modify data, and replot data. So I will do the same thing. That. So this is a simple program, if it wants, okay. Can't you see? Yeah? Well, this is a simple program which take 1 million points in a file, which is 781 megabytes, okay? And plot it. So it's a matrix of 11,000 by 8,000. So it's rather big. So you know the stack size in Scilab 5. So I put the maximum stack size. It's okay. Better? If I increase more, so, okay? And then I will I have a file which is 781 megabytes. Okay, it's a binary Scilab. You know, when you have a matrix, you can save it in internal binary Scilab format, which is HDF5. And I load it. Into Scilab. It's not possible. Not enough memory, not in that place in the memory. So, what I will show you is that there is a way this is Scilab 6 not so it exists okay Okay. And I will do the same first. I will do the same here. You can see it is well advanced. Okay. So 20. Okay. And I do the same. So I go here. This is, we don't need to use stack size. There is no stack. So we only have to load the file. And in 1 second, it downloads 100 million points. So it works. And now it's very easy. I open a window. Okay, here. And I plot in the window. It takes very short time, and we have here the figure. Very easy, 100 million points with Scilab 6. So it's only to show you that at Scilab Enterprise, we do something. We would like to have Scilab 6 more advanced, but you see, you can see that it works and that it's here. Okay? So, okay. $1 million question. What is the difference between MATLAB and Scilab? So, many people and many big companies ask us. So I will do very shortly this thing. You know that. You know MATLAB, you know Scilab, you know the difference, okay? But what I want to show you is the real difference we took the help file of the two software because I don't know how to make the comparison. And with this difference, we compared with the help file the functionality. So for the standard function, you see, elementary, linear algebra, sparse matrices, graphics, so on, it's comparable. I don't say that it's equivalent to the number of function, but it's a good measure of function. And I had a look of all the function to see what they do. So for standard, it's very similar. For numerical analysis, very similar, but Scilab has a part of signal processing. I'm comparing with MATLAB alone, without any toolbox. MATLAB alone, Scilab. Part of statistics toolbox and optimization toolbox in numerical analysis. Okay. When I am too far, it doesn't work. Over functions is only to say that we had a look on it. There is not a lot of difference. You can do nearly everything with the two software. Okay? But there are functions only in MATLAB. MATLAB, the MATLAB alone, without any toolbox. These are mainly data CDF, NCF, NCDF. I don't know if it is very useful, but they are format of data. And you have things like object-oriented of image and things like that. But for that, you can look for the external modules. You have seen the image, external module, serial port, external device, and so on. So if you really need this, I'm sorry, Scilab can now don't do this. But if somebody asks us and give us money, sorry, to do it, we can do it. This is the difference, okay? But there is another thing. This is only Scilab. So Scilab include control toolbox of MATLAB, include this kind of thing, and at the end, we have this scheme. This is Scilab. And this is the toolboxes. This corresponds to MATLAB, and this corresponds to MATLAB toolboxes. That means that Scilab has nearly all the optim toolboxes, optimization toolbox, nearly all the control toolboxes, an important part of the signal processing and a part of statistics. So one idea could be to complete what is not in the blue and to have all the functionalities. We will talk about that with Canaan, okay? So you can see that when you get Scilab, you get a lot of things. It's not only the MATLAB, it's Scilab plus control, signal, stat, optim. Okay? So it's very important that people are aware to that. So, how to use Scilab to finish? The calculator, migration from MATLAB to Scilab. No, everybody knows that. Migration from Excel to Scilab. This is a very important point because a lot of people in the world use Excel. The first numerical computation software in the world is Excel because it's free. No, free, but everybody has Microsoft Office, so they have Excel. And when you make numerical computation with Excel, it's not good. So it's very important if you are able to migrate from Excel to Scilab, okay? So this has a very important point. And we did this for the two French organizations. And we can be used, linked to other software, commercial or not. And you can make a complete application as Scilab module. For instance, Scilab is used on production site, ArcelorMittal, you should know, okay? Sanofi, Snecma, Sanofi for Elf. Okay. For internal use, Airbus, CNES, Dassault Aviation, French company for electricity, and in scientific domain, for instance, and I will finish with that, with the CNES, which is the French Space Agency.
So very fast, the CNES developed a module called Celeste Lab for dynamic, for space mechanics and dynamic. They are the specialists in this domain. They develop it in this domain, only Scilab code, and they decide to give it for free. So Celeste Lab is one of the module you can download. It is freely download, okay? And it make is to be made for mission analysis by the CNES and the European Space Agency. Okay? So it's only Scilab code. You have many, many functions. I think it's 200 or 300 functions. Okay. And they explain what they do. It made for when there is a mission in the space, they are able to take the data, to analyze the data, and to do a lot of things I'm not aware at all. It's not my domain, so it's only very complicated. And for instance, here, you have one example made with Scilab. You have a part of Europe with France, and you have a satellite. And we would like to know if we had to have this kind of orbit or this kind of orbit. This is the same satellite. And we have to, at any time, be able from this part to see a satellite. So they did it with Scilab and made the computation in order to see what is the best. And you can see here that, in fact, the best is this one. This animation is also made with Scilab, okay? And you can see that at every time there is a satellite, all people here can see the satellite. So this is an example of the use of Scilab in a real problem. But until now, it was the end of my talk. I let this and I get away, okay? Because I think it's very beautiful. But now there is more. Why? Because you know Philae that was put on the comet lately, after 10 years and so on. Can you believe me? Scilab was used in Philae mission. Us weren't aware of that. And I can prove it. Because when the Philae was put on the comet, okay, there were a movie made by the European Space Agency. And in this movie, at one moment, we see people in front of Scilab. So we send mail, is it Scilab? They say yes. Okay, this is in the space agency, and this is Scilab. So Scilab can be used for very, very important things, but 20 people come to a job. We try to do the job, and we need everybody in the world to continue the job, and that Scilab enterprise be able to continue to distribute the free Scilab and to have the best software we have. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Claude Gomez. I'm sure you now have a better idea what Scilab is. I throw open the session for questions. Please feel free to ask questions, not just about the present, past, even the future. Please.
You talked about integrating Fortran codes as a module. Are there examples available on the website to do that?
Yeah. In fact, on the Scilab website, there is a wiki. In the wiki, there are many things explained, and this is explained how to make the gateway, how to link the gateway with a Fortran code and so on. It's not very difficult. It's only to link the Fortran function
function or subroutine with the names, with something that will begin, will be the Scilab function. And if you cannot do it, I think that you will find people able to do it very easily.
From whatever paper presentations we saw and from your talk, we realized that Scilab is having a very big scope in terms of engineering as well as other fields of education. But is Scilab planning any planned effort? Like when you want people to contribute, have you identified some specific problems and then everybody come in, contributes to that problem? Or
which problem?
Do you invite people to contribute?
Yeah, sure.
Are some problems defined?
Yes, it's in the 20 people of Scilab Enterprise, there are 15 people in charge of development. Okay, and it's not enough. But we have now about 20 people, is not enough, but able to work with us to develop in Scilab code, not modules in the code of a core, not code, the Scilab distribution. So it's not so easy to do because the way we develop Scilab today is a way with we call professional with respect to research or something like that. For example, when they write one line of code, we call it a commit, but it's not put into Scilab. They need two other people to look at the code and to say it's good and so on. We have a lot of things like that. So the people want to make development into Scilab, in part of Scilab, they sign a paper with us, contract, okay? A sort of contract, and they follow this kind of development scheme. But it's evil. It's, we have people in the world very good in some domain, and they help us. The only problem is they have no deadline. We cannot ask them to do development for tomorrow or for, so it's this way of development. What I want to say is that it's not so easy to take charge of a people, of a community developing. The development of the software is not simple. You know the Mozilla Foundation with 200 people. Among these 200 people, there are 30 people in charge of the community. So it's a huge work. But it's possible, you already have people. There are people that disappear, and we don't have news. There are people that continue. This is the problem. But yes, it is possible. You have only to send mail to us and say, I'm an expert in this, and I want to help you with this. But not a problem. Micro. Okay.
Sorry. I think we should also talk about the Google Summer of Code and GSOC. The Google Summer of Code participation by Scilab, where people, students contribute.
What the people that help us?
The Google Summer of Code, GSOC.
I don't get it.
Scilab is a participant in Google's Summer of Code. You invite students every year to participate.
Yeah.
Internships.
Ah, internships. It's possible for us to have internship in Scilab Enterprise. This is a question.
Yeah, I mean, that is also one way people can contribute, especially students.
Yeah, yeah. We had internship students from France and from Brazil until now, and it's possible to have other internship. The only problem is that we are not in RIA. So we are not, we cannot have 20 internship guys, but one or two, this is possible. And every year on our website, there is a description of work. I don't know if it is in French or in English, but I can do that. And I can even, the best to do that is to have a contact here, okay? And for the internship, perhaps. I don't know how it works. But yes, it's possible. Because with internship, we can do some development, very interesting development. You're right.
Hello. You told Scilab has compatibility with C and Fortran. Is Scilab 6 has some compatibility with C++ also, because most of the open source softwares are now written in
C++. C++ is the same for us.
Oh, okay. Scilab. Oh.
From Scilab point of view, you can develop your code in C or C++. There is no difference.
Okay.
Okay.
Both can be.
Okay. Today, Scilab 5.5.1 is written in Fortran for the algorithms, a part of C for the algorithms, and Java for the graphic user interface. When you go to Scilab 6, all the kernel, the parser interpreter, is written in C++. And there are modules, external modules, written in C++.
Oh, okay.
So C++, no problem.
Okay, thanks.
Like the other programs get compiled into a standalone packages, is the future of Scilab, can we compile the Scilab modules or programs into a standalone binary package which can independently run on any operating system, whether it is Windows or whether it is Mac?
The question is, you have a module, you want to compile it?
And it can run without Scilab having on the other system.
You want to compile your module?
And make it a binary executable file, exe
or DMG file. But if your module depends on Scilab.
Yeah.
So if you compile the module, you get all Scilab with it. No? This is the problem. The problem of compiling is always the same. When somebody asks this kind of question, I ask, why? Why do you want to compile Scilab, or why to compile modules? Why? What is the reason?
Because some of the tablet Scilab won't work. Like iOS, Scilab will not work.
So it's not compiling a module, it's compiling Scilab. Compiling Scilab on iOS, compiling Scilab on Android, and so on. This is possible because people have compiled Scilab for iOS already, Scilab for Android. The only problem is the graphics, because all the LAPACK, all the matrix computation, and so on works. The problem is the graphic, because we are based on OpenGL. And I think it's problem with this phone and these systems. So compiling Scilab in these systems, there are problems for that, for user interface and graphics. It was a question? Okay. But there were tentatives to compile for Android. Ah, very complicated.
Can an entire Scilab application be embedded into another C program?
Yeah.
Along with the GUI?
Yeah. It's possible to take Scilab and to embed Scilab in another program. It's even possible to take Scilab and to have a light Scilab. Because, for instance, I was talking about ArcelorMittal for steel, okay? And they ask us a small Scilab to put on the plant. And we did it. Get rid of Xcos, get rid of the graphics, get rid of this, get rid of this. This is possible, to have a smaller Scilab. But the compilation of Scilab code into C, it depends why we want to do that. If it is for having a standalone program, it's very difficult. If it is only to not have a standalone program, there is no need.
Thank you. Actually, the speaker is going to be available. We actually have a longer tea break. So other questions, I would request you to talk to Dr. Gome during the tea break. During the tea break. So let's thank Dr. Gome.
Thank you.